consent in invasive procedures in radiology practice, that is consent in intervention radiology. Consent in context of doctor-patient relationship means the grant of permission by the patient for act to be carried out by the doctor. In the past, it was deemed that the patient should trust the doctor as a decision maker, but this began to change more than a century when the patient economy got importance. Radiology. Radiology is considered as a paraclinical specialty with minimal patient contact. However, the subspecialty of intervention radiology involves performing procedures on the patients. Intervention radiology is a medical subspecialty that performs various minimally invasive procedures using medical imaging guidance such as X-rays, fluoroscopy, IRTV systems, CT scan, ultrasound, or MRI. These procedures, which we carry on with the help of imaging systems, are angioplasty, that is repair or unblocking of blood vessels, stenting, small mesh tubes that treat narrow arteries, thrombolysis, dissolving blood clots, embolization to stop blood flows to the tumors, to reduce the size of tumors, radiofrequency ablation used to reduce nerve pains, biopsies, needle or catheter drainage of abscess or collection from the body and different organs. Intervention radiology is just like a micro-SS surgery, which is relatively faster than surgery, less expensive, and reduces the hospitalization period and minimizes the surgery-related complications. But with the IR, with this or the other risk and complications are associated depending on the diagnostic or therapeutic procedure to be performed, and hence the consent is mandatory. You will be shocked to know that about 24 to 40% patient needs further procedure or surgical interventions after the intervention radiology. So consent is mandatory in all intervention radiology procedures. Before planning a intervention procedure, there is a checklist which every radiologist should follow. Indication for procedure, questions to be answered from procedures, control indication for procedure, review prior imaging and non-invasive studies, check for contrast allergy, written informed consent, check coagulation parameters and KFT, need for prophylactic antibiotics, proper coverage should be there, patient should be fasting and well hydrated, and discontinue heparin infusion. So, understanding the concept of consent, what exactly the consent is? It's informed consent, involved risk and alternatives, unbiased information should be there, it's unambiguous and it should be lucid, and other is express consent. Informed consent in intervention radiology procedures. There should be proper preparation of the patient. Review the patient medical record, including pertinent laboratory tests, imaging and other data. Learn cultural background, personal and social history. Determine if the patient needs an interpreter or other communication aid, as there is a language problem in different states. And I prefer this particular radiology consent should be bilingual. Introduction. Introduce yourself and state your role in the patient's care, including the proposed procedure. Encourage active patient participation and shared communication with open-ended questions. Ask about values, goals, and expectations. And the core of this checklist, discuss the patient's current health problem as it relates to the proposed procedure. Explain the procedure, including how it will be performed, by whom, and how long it might take. Describe the benefits of the procedures as they relate to the patient's condition and the risk of not having the procedure. Describe the risk of procedure, include the risk that the procedure may not achieve the desired goal. And also describe the alternatives to the proposed procedure. Describe what to expect following the procedures. For example, amount and duration of pain, length of recuperation, limitations on activities of daily living, quality of life, and nowadays it has been added, how expensive if the complication occurs. That is also very important. Then review, elicit questions and concerns, check for patient understanding through teach back, review the written consent form with the patient, consider reading the form out loud or giving the patient opportunity to read the form alone. Allow time for additional discussion with family members. Emphasize that it is the patient's choice whether or not to consent to the procedure. Make sure the patient understands that the procedure cannot occur without their consent. And the most important thing, when to obtain consent. Ideally, 24 hours prior to the procedure, consent should be taken from the patient. Please stress on this. Ideally, 24 hours prior to the procedure, consent should be taken. But if there is an emergency consents, when there is a critical emergency, then it can be taken to save the life by taking into confidence the family members of the patient. A patient may be unconscious, small kid and attendant not available. There are some other methods which we can follow. With the prevalence of mobile devices that allow global communication at all times of the day, we can switch on the speaker and call the attendant and time permits consent taking an appropriate witness as defined by the local institution should be present together with the doctor taking the consent. The following is an example of how this may be done. Place the mobile device in speaker mode. Introduction of the doctor and witness to the parent or legal guardian. Inform the parent legal guardian that the consent taking process is being recorded using the mobile device if this is being done. Obtain an informed consent in the usual way as if the parent legal guardian is physically present. At the end of process, ask the parent legal guardian if he has any other questions or points to clarify. Ask the parent or legal guardian to repeat the information if possible and acknowledge that he understands to both the doctor and the witness. Inform the parent legal guardian that he will still need to sign the consent form retrospectively when he is physically present there. Enter contemporaneous notes into the patient's record. That is very important. Now, the question arises, this is the most neglected part of the informed consent. Who should obtain the informed consent for intervention procedures? Concerned or treating radiologists should obtain the consent. Consent taking may be delegated to the member of the intervention team, but the concerned person should be well versed with the procedure, its risk and complications. Still, the ultimate responsibility is of the performing radiologist. Mind it, still the ultimate responsibility is of the performing radiologist. So, consent should be comprehensive and should include explanation of procedure, discussion of benefits, its risk, complication may occur, or what is the alternative to this particular procedure. Prior to plan a procedure or counsel a patient for a particular procedure, radiologist should be well versed with the risk and complication that can occur after the procedure. and related to that particular procedure, and what will be the best alternative for that. So that's very important. We should know the complication which can occur by the procedure or the risk associated with the particular procedure. Until unless the performing radiologist don't know the complication, he will be in big trouble. So what sort of complication or risk associated with the intervention radiology procedures? The general risk or complications, allergic reaction to contrast, related with local or general anesthesia, rarely related to radiation, blood transfusion induced complications, or a vasovagal shock. Now, specific catheter angiography may be general or cardiac. Damage to blood vessel, pseudoaneurysm, hematomas, retroperitoneal bleeding, AV fistula formation, dissection of the vessel, myocardial infarction, strokes, or sometimes it's a very rare complication, but guide wire impaction. Then complication or risk in neuro interventions. Complications of endovascular treatment of intracranial aneurysm, that is the most common procedure which we follow. Aneurysm or vessel perforation that may lead to fetal hemorrhage, thromboembolism, coil dislodgement and embolization, coil stretching and unraveling, vessel injury, or rehemorrhage. In pulmonary intervention radiology, pneumonia is the most common complication, atelectasis, empyema, or pneumothorax, which may occur during the drainage or biopsies. Then hepatobiliary drainage in biopsies, hemorrhage, catheter dislodgement, bile leakage, cholangitis, sepsis, and I have faced one case, that's why I'm mentioning that, needle fracture or a guide wire fracture. Then peripheral vascular interventions, hematomas, pseudoaneurysms, and vessel rupture. In gynecological interventions, like uterine artery embolization, there is a chart we used to give to the patient who come for size of fibroid reduction or embolization for fibroids. This is a very good chart we used to give our patients. They themselves answer that, do I want to have children in the future? Do I want to avoid talking hormones or going through early menopause? Am I worried about complications such as pain or infection? Would I prefer to undergo a minimally invasive treatment over major surgery, even if it means I might have to go through the treatment again? Would a shorter recovery time to be preferable for my lifestyle? If the check three or more boxes they put as a positive, then we can plan for the uterine artery embolization. Fetal medicine. The most upcoming branch of intervention radiology includes ultrasound guided procedures in pregnancy, but a lot of risk and complications are associated with this. So I am like to mention that the termination of pregnancy, if at all it's precious, then it becomes a big problem. Loss of more than one fetuses while fetal reduction. Permanent sterility may occur, or lethal hemorrhages. There should be a very good detailed consent if you are dealing with fetal medicine. There is a sample. Doctor to cross out and initial any statements on the generic medical imaging consent not relevant to this patient's procedure. In recommending the procedure, the doctor believes the benefits to you from having the procedure exceed the risk involved. The risk and complication with this procedure can include but are not limited to the following. The common risk and complication may include bruising may occur, failure of local anesthesia, nerve damage. Less common risk and complication include miscarriage or premature labor. This can be due to bleeding from the uterine wall or the unborn baby, leaking of fluid from the amniotic sac, infection introduced into the abdominal wall. The procedure may not be possible due to medical or technical reasons. Rare risk and complication, bleeding from your unborn baby circulation into your circulation, which could lead to miscarriage or development of antibodies against the unborn baby blood. An injection of anti-D is given to rhesus negative women to prevent antibody development. Damage to surrounding structures such as blood vessels, organs and muscles requiring further treatment. An allergy to injected drugs requiring further treatment. Seizures or cardiac arrest due to local anesthesia toxicity. And death as a result of this procedure is very rare. So this is a detailed consent form which includes the risk and complication which should be given to the patient while performing fetal medicine. So, in short, ingredients of informed consent, 5 do's, make sure the patient understands nature of his condition, the alternate procedures, nature of proposed anesthesia, risks of proposed or alternate procedures, and chances of success or failure of the procedure. 5 don'ts. Don't inform the patient that you are going to do a routine procedure as none is routine. That the procedure is simple, nothing simple in the medical science. That no complication will occur because complications can and do occur. Don't omit to record denied consent. Don't take the patient's consent just moments before the procedure, as already I have mentioned earlier. Then informed consent and negligence. Obtaining consent is no defense against gross negligence, as it was discussed at length in the last seminar. Not obtaining informed consent may be ground for negligence if expected sequelae is not communicated. Record keeping. Legally, what is not documented never happened. Record keeping and documentation of patient, it is the most important factor of every procedure. Most deficient area in medical practice. Good records critical to delivery of quality medical care and best defense against allegations. Good record, good defense. Poor record, poor defense. No record, no defense. Remember, you have one and only chance to submit your evidence at first court only. In 40% litigations, I am sorry to say that, doctor is behind the doctor. Doctor is behind the doctor. Do not criticize your colleague. Do not sponsor litigation. You may be the next victim. These are the few sample forms which we are using. These are the used in the high-risk procedures. It is a bilingual, English and Hindi, as MP is the state where Hindi is the main language. And this is the detailed informed consent before the procedure, which includes everything, including anesthesia, the procedure, and the explanation, and the doctor's details. Thank you. Thank you very much for giving me the opportunity, and thank you for patient hearing. Thank you very much, sir.